Tonight, this is an Arshag Fetvajian Memorial Lecture. It is the fifth. So I want to thank Barbara Fetvajian and the Fetvajian family, and we remember longtime NAASR member and friend Arshag Fetvajian at these lectures, which have been all on art and architecture related subjects. So this seemed an appropriate time to hold another. I want to thank also our co-sponsors for this evening, the Armenian Library and Museum of America, ALMA. And to that end, I'd like to invite ALMA curator Gary Linsanadian to come up and say a few words. Gary.
Thank you. I'll keep it very brief. Hello. We have an exhibit on Fetvajian, which was actually based on his book, primarily, at the museum, which is only up until through this weekend. We held it over until his talk. So if you want to see it, please come soon. Actually, well, during the weather, maybe not. Sorry. And also, something linked to this, by the way, which is strictly coincidental, is I just got an email from a Russian art dealer in Atlanta, Georgia, who's a friend of a friend of somebody in Tiflis, and that somebody in the Tiflis is trying to sell a Fetvajian. And this is the Fetvajian here. I hope it's not hot. you never know. Anyway, if it's only 20,000, so if you're interested in buying one, let me know afterwards.
Let's pass the hat.
And without further ado, back to Mark.
Okay, thanks, Gary. And without further ado, I'd like to ask our chairman, Rafi, would like to say a few words as well.
Well, I want to add my welcoming remarks as well. This is the kind of function we'd like to collaborate with ALMA and have a good showing of participants in the lecture that we're hoping Dr. Chookaszian is going to give, an interesting lecture. I just want to mention that seats are filling up fast on the NAASR planned tour to historic Armenia. We can handle only 22 people, two minibus loads worth, and there's only a choice reserved seating available, and they're going fast. So if you're thinking of going, this is the time to make your reservations. I think we have almost 16 people already subscribed to go, so we have room for up to six more coming up. So, with that, welcome again and enjoy the evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Rafi. Two events coming up that I wanted to mention. On Monday, Tuesday, February 19th, we will be having a lecture here by Professor Stephen L. Jacobs of the University of Alabama on Raphael Lemkin and the Armenian Genocide. This event will be co-sponsored by the Temple Isaiah in Lexington, Mass. And NAASR, and we hope you can join us to welcome Professor Jacobs, who is a new speaker to this area, certainly, but a distinguished scholar of Holocaust and Genocide studies and one of the leading experts in the world on the work of Raphael Lemkin. On Thursday, March 14th, we'll be welcoming writer Aris Janikian, who will be giving a talk entitled Exile, Memory, and Assimilation, the Armenian Experience as the Essential American Experience. And I think it'll be his first talk in this area as well, so we hope you can join us on those occasions. It's been almost 20 years since our speaker tonight first spoke at NAASR, and we've been fortunate enough to have him here with us on numerous occasions since then. Although, it's been several years since we've been able to welcome him here in Belmont, six or seven, I think, anyway. Although he has given talks for us in other locations. We're delighted to have him back again. Professor Levon Chookaszian is the UNESCO Professor of Armenian Art at Yerevan State University. He's one of the world's leading authorities on Armenian art and architecture. He's written really an absurd number of books and articles on the subject. He was showing me what I think is probably only a partial listing of them earlier, and it goes into the several hundreds. His expertise covers a broad swath of territory, and just looking over some of the talks he's given here through the years, he's covered an incredible diversity of topics. Tonight, he'll be talking about the noted artist Arshag Fetvajian. Professor Chookaszian is the author and compiler of this very attractive book, the first book of its kind that's been done on Fetvajian, who is, you'll hear, is a fascinating and important artist. And the book, of course, is available in the bookstore. We hope you'll be interested and buy copies, and I know the professor would like that as well, and he would be delighted to sign them for you afterwards. So please welcome back Professor Levon Chookaszian.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am very grateful to Mark Mamikonian for this introduction. Also to Mr. Rafi Gayan for opening and for giving this chance to represent the book of Fetvajian and tell about him. And also to Gary Lin Sinanyan, whom I haven't seen many years, and who represents the Armenian Library and Museum of America. And this is due to administration of museum, library, that this event will take place today. I am in a strange situation because, and meantime, I am very happy that I am bridging two Arshaks, Arshag the Merkerian and Arshag Fetvajian. Arshag Mergerian, who was a lover of legacy of Fetvajian and a very nice person whom I was privileged to meet and to talk, and who also informed me about a very important survey made in California, and I met author Alice Navasargyan and inspired her to publish that important survey on Persian Armenian painters, and due to that we have a luxury book which is a textbook for our students who explore the legacy of Armenian Iranian painters. So this title, Arshag Ermerkerian Lectures Series, is for me special title of special importance. And another Arshag Fetvajian, is somebody who changed my life. I can say this because it was just accidentally that I started to explore his work and his life. One day I was passing street in Yerevan, and I have met famous philologist, historian, ethnographer Arakel Patrick, who was one of the students of Daniel Varujan, famous Armenian poet, killed by Turks during genocide. And Arakel Patrick, who made with my father Hushamadian of Sebastia, two volumes about Sebastia people and their culture, history, he asked me, why you don't explore the life of Arshag Fetvajian and his work? He's absolutely unique figure in our culture, and it is very interesting all what he have done. Of course, I have heard the name of Fetvajian. His name was not unknown to me, but it is one thing when the name is unknown, and it is another thing when you have a chance year by year to explore his life and work, step by step to follow his life and his creations. And this was also another strange coincidence that the from the board of redaction of Armenian Soviet Encyclopedia, I got an invitation to contribute to the work of Encyclopedia and to prepare several articles, and among them I had the chance to choose the article paper about Arshag Fetvajian. I started this as a small paper for Encyclopedia, and then it took part of my life. I am very happy that these two chances with in my life, and they brought me to Boston finally, where Arshag Fetvajian spent 25 years of his life. This is another world which I have discovered in Boston. I understood the milieu of Fetvajian. I was in many places where Fetvajian was, and it expanded my horizon. Living with Fetvajian already in Boston, in America, being in New York, looking his work in Massachusetts, in different places. And, you know, many art historians were not so happy. I can consider myself as a happy person that I had a chance to travel with Fetvajian, as if he was accompanying me during the last 30 years. I have visited especially Tbilisi, Georgia, in 1985 to meet daughter or brother of Fetvajian, Isabella Fetvajian, and to speak about Fetvajian, to collect memories, and also I had the chance to have access to old Armenian press in our libraries in Yerevan, in public library, or later it became National Library, to see hieronyms and to see a lot of materials. And also I have received many articles from Lusik Demavelian, from other people who knew Fetvajian, in who were still living. And when I combined all this documentation, I came to conclusion that Arshag Fetvajian is not just a painter, he is the greatest contributor to Armenian culture. He is one of the forerunners of those forerunners who started exploration of Armenian art when there were not so many books, not so many articles published in different languages, who started systematic exploration of Armenian art and culture, Armenian art and architecture. And this was very touching for me, because simultaneously I was exploring the legacy of Garagin, Hosepian's former Catholicos of Cilicia, who was also excellent scholar, and another popularizer of Armenian culture, Arshag Chobanyan, writer, editor, art critic. And suddenly I saw that the paths of these people are crossed several times, that they knew each other, that they were collaborating with each other. They, together with starting exploration of Armenian art and architecture. And I can say that Fetvajian enriched my life. And he was example for copying and following his mission. And suddenly I have discovered that he was lecturing also about Armenian art. In Boston and in other places. I understood that it's necessary to continue this work, which was cut, and due to these examples of Fetvajian, Garagin Hovsepian, and Arshag Chobanyan, I decided to start world lectures on Armenian art. On Armenian art on different topics, and 20 years I am doing that in different countries of Europe and America and Canada and Middle East. And I have been traveling in numerous places. I have met a lot of people who invited many times to see their collections, to see something from Fetvajian that they had in their private collection. I was privileged to work in San Lazzaro, in Venice Mkhitaryist congregation, to see the work of Fetvajian, famous portrait of Armenologist Levon Chookaszian. Made by Fetvajian, who himself encouraged Fetvajian to explore, to start exploration of Armenian art and serving to Armenian culture. And I remember that I was looking in the streets of Rome, Italy, those places from where Fetvajian was able to portray this or the other part of Rome. And those places were completely changed. There were new streets, new buildings. I remember I was chasing after the articles of Fetvajian in the libraries of Moscow, in libraries of St. Petersburg, because there were articles written about him in Russian. I can't say that all my researches were really successful. In certain cases, I was unable to find this or the other issue of this or the other journal or newspaper. But still, the bibliography, which is located in the book on Fetvajian, I think it's the only bibliography which still exists, articles that he published himself about Armenian art and culture, articles, books that were mentioning his name and his work, and or were completely devoted to him. And I think that I did my best, and I hope that the book will encourage appearance of numerous other articles and books, and numerous other scholars will continue to work on it. And I was lecturing each time about Fetvajian to my students in Yerevan, and I am lucky that one of them, Gohar Chemenyan, was so much fascinated by art of Fetvajian and chained by his legacy that she herself started catalog of paintings of Fetvajian. And finally, there was opened exhibition of Fetvajian's works in our National Gallery 2 years ago. It was important. It was important event. And meantime, it was beginning of another process of returning name of Fetvajian to our people, because unfortunately, he was forgotten. And not only he, during the last 20 years, I can say that our people became more backwards during so-called independence of Armenia. Our people and the young generation, they read less, they are informed less, all television programs are not anymore including the programs made by art experts. So step by step, we are going back. And unfortunately, this process is very strong, and intellectuals in Armenia fight against this as much as they can. And publication of Book of Fetvajian is another start. It is start of a series of books which will be devoted to different forgotten painters. And with appearance of each book, the name of Fetvajian will be more and more higher, because anybody who will buy second or third or fourth volume, suddenly, if he will get it in some bookstore, will chase after first book to have a complete set, and he will be interested to know who is Fetvajian when he will get it. And so this will be first series of Armenian artists' legacy publications, and never we had such a series of books. And it is luxury for people like we, for a poor country like Armenia. Only, you know, big superpowers or big countries, European countries, can have this chance to have series of books devoted to their painters or world painters. And also, this event exposition devoted to Fetvajian was a chance to publish first catalog about his works, those that were located in Armenia in the National Gallery of Yerevan. And when I was already editing that catalog written by Gohar Chemenyan, my former student, I understood that we seriously need numerous publications about Fetvajian. And I have selected for the book on Fetvajian those paintings which were not preserved in Yerevan collections. Of course, I have included artworks from National Gallery and also Ecme Azin Palace of Catholicos, but I decided to include paintings which were far from Armenia, and Armenian art scholars had no access to that. So the catalog of Fetvajian made by Vlad Chevenian and my book, they somehow put in circulation more paintings as it was possible to do only with the collections in Armenia. And now I can say that this fact makes easier for students to write different things on Fetvajian, because if the students, they don't have access to originals in museums, because they are students, now they can use the books. And so I hope that in coming decades, more people will be involved in that. I see that students are interested in Fetvajian. And I know that already another catalog on Fetvajian's sketches of ornaments of Armenian churches is ready by Goar Chemenyan, and they are preparing new exhibition of those 1,600 sketches that are preserved in our National Gallery. Can you imagine about what I am talking now? Can you imagine that one person during his life can go from church to church, from Khachkar to Khachkar, from Tomsk to the other Tom, and copy all the ornaments alone, without any grant and fellowship, without any cars or buses or other possibilities of transportation? Can you imagine that this person was without such special funding and without patronage? He was making himself decision, he was himself trying to get money for that, he made unusual job. He registered situation with Armenian ornamented surfaces, which in certain cases don't exist or are damaged now, because they were in Turkey, nobody was taking care of those churches or the Khachkars or Tom sculptures, but they were destroyed and damaged. So Fetvajian did a work which usually institutes were unable, or institutes are unable to do now. And also, let's not forget about watercolors that he made. There are unusual watercolors. There are big size watercolors, because usually watercolors are small. And big watercolor paintings of Armenian churches that he made, those are, and not only surprising, but they were surprising already when they were in exhibits at the beginning of 20th century in Tbilisi, in Batumi, in Baku, and later in other countries such as France, such as England, such as America. Can you imagine that one person was able, during genocide and after genocide and before genocide, to gather all this material, to show it, to expand the knowledge of people about their legacy, about their national identity, about their artistic past? Can you imagine one person is doing such a work and understanding that it is nobody else can do that? He's understanding his mission. He's understanding that only he can do that. And he's proud and strong that he is doing that. Fetvajian is not just a painter. Fetvajian is inspiring people. And Fetvajian was not just a painter or lecturer or explorer of Armenian art. When he was lecturing to refugees in America, refugee Armenians who came as immigrants without passports, who were known already as starving Armenians. Can you imagine that he was lecturing to these people, and people who were hopeless, who were neglected by Germans or other nations living in America, who were without normal living, and who lost their relatives, who lost their houses, who lost their friends, who didn't know where are still surviving people whom they knew, or have they survived. And all these people living with such divided identity, with remembrances, with memories about lost country, and with adaptation to new life, which was absolutely not patriarchal, as their homeland. Can you imagine that these people, when they were coming to his lectures, sitting next to Germans, French, or Irish, or other people, who were just curious about Armenian art and came due to their friend who was Armenian, who came to see who is this person who is lecturing about art, Armenian art, what is Armenian art, what is Armenian, what is Armenia? Who, these refugees, were observing that their friends of non-Armenian origin are very much inspired by this legacy. And they were very proud that these people were admiring Armenian art. So Fetvajian was giving strength to refugees, giving pride to refugees, giving them hope for better life. And I told many things about Fetvajian. Let's tell you about certain biographic facts. Fetvajian, born in Trebizond in 1866, in a very nice family, who were not poor, who were rich, also who were from noblemen, having noble origins, who were originating from Erzurum, Garin, and whose history was about 300 years old, and Fetvajian knew about that. He was fluent from his childhood, not only in Armenian, also in Turkish, also in French, and even Russian, and when he was a kid, he was even visiting Batumi and also Russian cities near Black Sea shore, and where his relatives were living. And later, Fetvajian, after finishing secondary school in Trebizond, he entered fine art school, new established fine art school in Constantinople. This had happened in 1882, when just school was opened. And he was one of the first students, and he finished that school with best marks. So he was selected to be sent to Rome with special prize, which was established by Turkish government. And then suddenly appeared somebody, some very noble, some very important person, and he suggested to Fetvajian, he invited Fetvajian to his house, suggested to him to refuse this prize given by Turks and to receive money from him, and with that money to go and continue his education in Italy. And he asked Fetvajian to never open the name of this donator. Fetvajian promised. We suspect that this was Voskan Martikian, who was minister of post in Ottoman Empire, member of the government, very much respected by Armenians and Turks. And then Fetvajian appeared in Rome. He entered San Luca Academy in Rome in 1886, and he graduated there, and afterwards he went to Vienna in 1891. But before it, Fetvajian was in different cities, not only in Italy, but also in other European countries. So he started exploration and recognition of world art in the famous museums of Europe. Fetvajian, when he visited Venice and came to San Lazzaro, he met Levon Chookaszian, who, as I have already mentioned, inspired him, who showed him Armenian illustrated manuscripts in San Lazzaro collection, and told him that it is necessary to serve to Armenia, making all these artifacts known to Armenian people and non-Armenian people. So this way Fetvajian entered the world of Armenian art. But before starting to work as an explorer, he went to Vienna. He stayed there in Vienna several years, 4 years, and later he moved to St. Petersburg. And everywhere he was making portraits, he was making landscapes, he was portraying different people of different nations. And when he was in St. Petersburg, he immediately became known among Russian painters and was invited to become a member of the Professional Society of Russian Painters. And even Russian art critics wrote about him, encouraging articles. And then Fetvajian started his expositions in Tbilisi, in Batumi, in Baku, from the end of 19th century, at the beginning of first years of 20th century. Arshag Fetvajian was in St. Petersburg, and then this is portrait of Levon Chookaszian, which is in San Lazzaro, and it is a not small, I mean not a very big portrait, it is in the room where Chookaszian was living. And Chookaszian, by the way, asked Fetvajian to copy certain miniatures from illustrated manuscripts of San Lazzaro collection. And when Fetvajian did that for the books of forthcoming books of Chookaszian, and Chookaszian suggested him money for that, he refused that and only asked that he wants to portray famous scholar, world famous scholar. And such so was in this way created this portrait. Being in Italy, he portrayed also ancient monuments, remnants of Greco-Roman architecture, and portraits different scenes from Venice, and he portrayed certain paintings which became later quite popular among Armenians. And also now you can see certain examples of Armenian miniatures which we can meet in the books of Chookaszian. Those are copied from the manuscripts. This work of famous Armenian painter Ignatius from 13th century. And due to these paintings, due to these copies of Fetvajian, Armenian society, Armenian public was able to acquaint himself with Armenian book illumination. Those were the first specimen of Armenian book illumination ever published in color. And this is for beginning of 14th century and illustrates famous historical figures from Glazov University. And even 16th, 17th century miniatures, which one can see in those books, they are of great importance for all those who are exploring Armenian miniature painting. And they encouraged other scholars to start exploration of Armenian book illumination. Of course, now these illustrations are published in better quality. Of course, numerous others were put into circulation from this collection, but still, these are the first examples. And even he copied very famous Byzantine miniatures, such as this painting showing Gregory Illuminator from the a famous manuscript ordered by Byzantine Emperor Basil Bulgaroktonos. He portrayed women from high societies in Vienna, and not only women from high societies, even the ambassador of Iran, Nariman Khan Enikolopian, he ordered portraits of Shah of Iran and his vizier. So, he was doing a lot of work as orders, already being in Vienna. And certain paintings that he made, of course, they are, I can't say that they are lost, but we don't know their present location. And I hope that the book of Fetvajian will inspire the other people who can understand the importance of this painter, and they will make me know, and other scholars, about location of other paintings. He illustrated numerous books, illustrated different things which are not only of artistic importance, also archaeological importance. There are excellent portraits of women. I can say that he is one of the best portraitists in our art. And importance of Fetvajian in our Armenian art, it's also due to the high quality of art. All of us, we know about Vatkes Surenyans, who was living parallelly to Fetvajian. We know that this was another brilliant intellectual. And he is more known, and many people are fond of Surenyans. But if you will look the fingers, that are hands that are portrayed in the paintings of Surenyans, and compare them with that mastery with which Fetvajian portrayed hands, you can see that Fetvajian is much stronger in this sense. Fetvajian represented women in Istanbul, women in Russia, in Italy. Wherever he was going, he was interested in unusual architectural monuments and also interesting ethnographic types of people, the anthropological types of people. Here you can observe Sheikh, one so-called Islamic leader from somewhere here. He can be Kurd, probably. And this is important from ethnographic point of view also. And he represented famous mausoleums of Sultan Mehmed II here. And in other cases, we can see landscapes as here. And during his first expositions in Kokazi, the visitors who came to see these paintings, they were mentioning the mastery of painter, but they were saying that you can't find much of Armenian life or Armenian types in those expositions. So Fetvajian step by step started his visits, his field work. He entered Armenia, and first meeting with homeland was very touching for him. After knowing Europe, after seeing architectural monuments, architectural buildings in excellent shape, suddenly he saw Armenian buildings in ruins. He saw Armenian churches damaged, abandoned, and step by step, some protest, as he is writing, appeared in his soul. Some protest against this injustice. And he started to portray Ani, ancient capital of Armenia, of Bagratid dynasty. And this is Vartapet Mikhail of Ani. This is a small portrait of a person who was very attentive, not only to Fetvajian, who was portraying architectural buildings, but he was also helping, supporting, cooking something or preparing tea for Toros Toramanyan, who was also working at that time in Ani, who was a famous explorer of Armenian architecture. So he was also one of forerunners. And these people started gigantic work. They were understanding that they are moving a big mountain. Big mountain, and they were moving those mountains, moving small stones, step by step. And Fetvajian portrayed Armenian churches of 10th, 11th centuries. And when we compare this situation, state of preservation of these churches with their present state presentation, we see great difference. We see that Fetvajian registered state of preservation and registered forever. Now we can find in the same situation. For instance, this is the Cathedral of Ani. And after earthquake, this part is missing already. This cathedral was erected by Queen Katranite, and it is one of the gems of Armenian architecture. Unfortunately, quite strange thing that I might not say that. Unfortunately, from Armenian side now, and this is on the border with Turkey, on Turkish territory. Unfortunately, from Armenian side, it's already many years that they are exploding cutting the stones for buildings. There are mines of tuff next to it, on our side. Each time when there is explosion, these churches are suffering from that. And also they are suffering from earthquakes, which are quite frequently here. So all kind of complaints, all kind of protests don't help. Even Turks are protesting. And Fetvajian already making many paintings on this issue, he decided to publish them as postcards. He went to Vienna, and in 1906 in Vienna he published these postcards, and he decided to introduce this way Armenian public with those architectural works. And he was trying to introduce these buildings as the gems of Armenian architecture, not just as ruins of different buildings. In certain cases, the churches or monasteries don't exist anymore. As here, one can see that this is completely destroyed by Turks. It is exploded. Even dynamite was photographed by Armen Hakhnazarian, which didn't exploit some part of building. But this is a very famous monastic complex, Horomos complex, which was surviving till 1920. And this one, this is a pagan temple transformed into Christian temple, which is decor, and it is unique example of pagan Armenian architecture, which survived those days when Fetvajian was painting that. It doesn't exist. Only due to this painting, only due to the survey of Toros Toromanian, that we can have an idea about decor. Magasbert, this is a fortress next to Ani, near the canyon. And Magasbert is not so much accessible for scholars. Only Nicole Thierry with husband, Jean-Michel Thierry, French, two scholars, they have visited this place, filmed it. And when he was working in this area, or wherever he was going, Fetvajian was doing his sketches. He was doing with pencil. They are made exclusively with great accuracy. When you see how they are preserved, it's and how they are brought next to each other. Let's see column in this case. How is decorated this column? How is decorated another column in another church? And next to it another church column, another church column. You see the series of columns which are illustrated in different forms. He was very attentive to any ornaments which were appearing next to window, which were appearing next to the door, above the door. And can you believe that somebody can devote his energy, his vision to such a meticulous work? Can you believe that this was a person who was not just aesthetic, he was not just a lover of Armenia, he was kind of fanatic. He was understanding that only now, as if he was understanding that it will not be accessible for other scholars after 10 years or 15 or 20 or 30. He was understanding, maybe he was feeling, maybe some power was directing him, telling that you have to do this now, now and not later. And it's pity that all this was so many years in repository of National Gallery. It's pity that all this was not accessible to scholars. It's pity that there were no possibilities, there was no manpower to explore all this. That can you believe published all this during the period of Fetvajian? Can you believe how much farther we were able to go in our research? How many people were able to be inspired by this work and create their own researches? Fetvajian was not just portraying architectural buildings, churches, monasteries. He was portraying the costumes of Armenian women of different regions. This is something else. Maybe he was feeling that nobody will be able to do that after 20, 30, 40 years. Maybe he was had this strange feeling that it will disappear. Of course it disappeared. Genocide, 6 years, 7 years between 1915 and 1922 or 1923, genocide years with numerous refugees who escaped from their houses with one dress, with their national costumes, they were destroyed. They disappeared. These people were living on the ground, sitting, sleeping, cooking, dying on the ground. They were burning them, 5,000 people, in one grave in 1916, after exodus from Van. When they reached Yerevan, Echmiadzin, in August, imagine, hot weather, no shade, no houses, no food, no restrooms, ecological disaster, catastrophe. Can you imagine all these people? What costume? Costume was not surviving. But he started this work. He portrayed, this is Trebizond, women from Trebizond. He portrayed Russian princesses. He portrayed here the women from Trebizond, from Karin, sorry. From Oshakan and from Gyumri. This is one of refugee kids in costume of Shatach, one day carrier, from Mox Shatach. People were dressed like this. And with the beginning of First World War, Fetvajian, he was facing another difficulties. He was facing difficulties with problems of refugees. He was observing their situation. And many painters were unable to tolerate this. Martiros Starian, psychologically depressed, was taken by friends away from this area because he get ill. He gets sick from the situation of refugees. The other painters were still able to portray refugees, like Fetvajian, Surinians, Sarkis Khachaturian, and others. And Fetvajian was not only portraying. Fetvajian was writing about this situation. He illustrated cover of booklet which was published devoted to Armenian volunteers who came to revenge for their homeland and their people. And he also illustrated cover of a book called Tziteni. Tziteni is tree of olive tree. And this is also showing the Armenian fidain or Kirilla dying and wife mourning above his dead body. Fetvajian was meantime participating in some expositions of Armenian painters, and Armenian painters organization was established in Tbilisi, Georgia, Tiflis, and they were doing some selling of paintings and fundraising to help their compatriots. And then with the appearance of First Armenian Republic, Fetvajian was called to government. Aram Manukyan called him and asked that it's necessary to print Armenian paper money, banknotes, and also Armenian stamps. So he illustrated this. We have some archival documentation that Hakob Kocayan also participated in that, and Fetvajian edited it. But in certain sources, Simon Vratsian is writing in his book on Armenian Republic that Fetvajian did completely. But we have also archival documents, which I haven't included in my book. And then Aram Manukyan told him to go to France and to publish this. Armen Garo Pastermajan, he sent money from America, and then Fetvajian with some other people went to France, to Paris, and printed first stamps. He didn't like the quality that editorial house Chassepo made, and he decided to print banknotes of paper money in London. He went to London and he got another publishing house and published excellent quality of banknotes, which are still observable in markets of Yerevan. And unfortunately, they were not in time, because only part was shipped to Armenia. And when Armenia, Soviet power was established in Armenia, Soviet government had forbidden the use of these stamps and banknotes, and part of printed material stayed in London, in France, and then it was sold to numismatic stores. Fetvajian used this chance to expose his paintings, and leaders of first government, they were understanding, their representatives in France, they were understanding that there is necessary to make some lobbying for new country. And so, under the patronage of very famous scholars, such as members of French Academy, Charles Dill and Gustave Schlumberger, in Louvre was organized exposition of Fetvajian. Paintings showing Armenian architecture, Armenian costumes, Armenian miniatures, they were exposed. Armenian sculptures, they were exposed there. And French newspapers, Armenian newspapers, they have published interesting articles on this. And then he received an invitation, some chance to expose his works in Royal Institute of British Architects, and also even to have a chance to publish an article about Armenian architecture in their journal, and he did it. And then he received invitation to represent his collection in Victoria and Albert Museum in London. He did it. British press, British art scholars, they have written about it because it was discovery for them. Of course, at that time also was published a book of Josef Strzygowski, professor of Vienna University, Armenia in German language, the Balkans, the Armenia und Europa, Europe and architecture of Armenia, where he was showing many specimens of Armenian architecture and showing their similarities with European architecture. This was discovery for scholars of Europe, but also America, but they were unable to see all these things in color. Fetvajian's expositions were giving a chance to scholars to see also polychromy of Armenian architecture, because Armenian architecture is polychromic. It is in not one color. And so Fetvajian did excellent job, but he was unable to go back to Armenia. And he was hoping that leaving Britain, going to America, will give him a chance to publish his collection, because he was understanding that it's necessary to publish all these works in special album. He got invitations from British Institute of from Royal Institute of British Architects, but only a small portion of his work. They were unable to give more money for that. War was just finished and they were in financial bad situation, but Fetvajian refused. Unfortunately refused. Unfortunately refused, and this chance disappeared. Many years he was unable even to publish, to print only even portion of that. He went to America. He came to America, and already being in America, he found himself in absolutely another world. He came from classical world, from old world, with Gothic, Romanesque, ancient Greek and Roman architecture. He suddenly appeared, he got himself in some milieu which was not even reminding him that atmosphere. And in this situation, he was visited by Manuel de Manuel, one of the four consuls of First Republic in America. Manuel de Manuel, talented person who was successful in his business, who was also intellectual and able to evaluate another intellectual's work. He immediately understood who is before him. He understood the importance of Fetvajian. And he asked him, where are you going? What are you doing here? How you will survive? Do you have money? Fetvajian was in a desperate situation. He was ready to kill himself. And he said, no money, no connections. He was ready to leave country with the rest of money, which was only sufficient for ticket. Manuel de Manuel decided to bring him to Boston, to his family, and in this way, Fetvajian appeared in Boston. Family of de Manuel became not only just shelter for him, he got his family. He was never married, not having children. And in that family were three children who are now absolutely not children anymore. they became family of Fetvajian. They loved him, he loved them. And parents were very attentive to Fetvajian. They were respecting, taking care of him. And this way, Fetvajian received very important, essential support, another stimulation for living farther. And of course he was missing Armenia, he was missing Armenian architecture, he was unable to portray anymore another churches, but he was dreaming to publish his work. And being already during his stay in America, some fundraising was started among Armenians for publishing his book. And he was very happy that such activity appeared. But unfortunately, the money was not enough. Only this board, fundraising board, was able to publish a board brochure with color reproductions, black and white reproductions of his works, for introducing Armenian public in America with the work of Fetvajian. But the financial situation of Armenian public in America was also absolutely not corresponding to this goal, to this target. And it never happened. He wasn't able to publish. But he started to lecture about Armenian art. He started to meet his friends, to meet people who were very important people in modern history of Armenia, who were also immigrants, who came to America hoping that again they will be able to go back to their homeland. He became very friendly with Chuck Makchan, famous chemist and author of best dictionary, Armenian, English, English-Armenian dictionary, best dictionary ever I have met, and who was editor of Hellenic. And Chuck Makchan wrote very interesting articles about lectures of Fetvajian, about his expositions in different halls in Boston and in New York. And of course, Fetvajian was able to go to see museums in Boston, to see the masterpieces of world art located in those museums. He was fond of a public library in Boston where he was reading books and working on his never published service. Can you imagine somebody who was living in America without any essential grants and essential funding, sitting in libraries and writing world art history? He wrote the history of Armenian art and architecture, Russian art, Dutch art, English art, Byzantine art, Greek and Roman arts. He was writing it, also cutting illustrations from different journals and newspapers, gluing next to his handwritten articles, putting bibliography, articles, what is or books, what are possible, what are accessible for reading on this or the other topic. Can you imagine that some person was sitting and writing all this, even not able publishing his paintings, but dreaming that maybe his books will be published? They were never published. They are in his archive in National Gallery of Art of Armenia. And unfortunately, we missed this chance during Soviet period. Nobody was seriously interested in his legacy till 80s. So 40 years, those writings and those paintings were in depositories in archive of National Gallery. And now our students are using books on world art history written in Russian, still in Russian, because all our education in Armenia, in Georgia, in other former Soviet republics, all education in all universities, in physics, mathematics, everything, it is in Russian language. Even Georgia, which is trying to force somehow to Russian, even there, they are independent, because it is cost a lot of money, publication of books on this or the other professions. But how we lost the chance to publish these books and go farther in our education, on our teaching of students to world art history, written by such an expert who was acquainted with these art treasures, looking them in their real location, in this or the other famous European museum. Fetvajian visited Germany, visited France, visited Greece, visited Egypt, visited Belgium, and etc. He saw the best things which are located in Europe. So he was the right person to write this history, but never that happened. Fetvajian made this excellent portrait of Armenuhi at Ermanuelian. And this is one of his best portraits. In this house, Fetvajian was living with a family of the Ermanuelians when he came to Boston. And later on Dwight Street, he got this apartment, Dwight Street 20, with help of Manuel Ermanuelian. And this was reminding him England, this New England type streets. And he used to go to promenade in these streets. And Fetvajian was taking part in all important events of Ermanuelian's family. And he is the godfather of marriage of Vigent Ermanuelian. And Manuel Ermanuelian was trying to help him in other ways, also to find some orders. Some Italian companies were giving job to Fetvajian. Also, he decorated certain Armenian churches in Worcester, in Lowell, in New York, 27th Street, St. Gregory Illuminators Church. And also in Wollstone Cemetery, they have erected this hachkar that he decorated, and this is on the grave of famous actor and regisseur Hovhannes Zarifian. Fetvajian was very close to different people, different intellectuals, as I said. Famous photographer and painter John Karoyan, or John Karo, he made photographic excellent portrait of Fetvajian. Fetvajian made his portrait, but unfortunately we don't know where is it now. John Karo was teacher of Yusuf Karsh. Yusuf Karsh was in his studio, and his studio was visited by Kusevitsky, by Caruso, by other famous American intellectuals. And he was very close to Chuck Markchan, as I said, also to Armenuhi. Armenuhi.
to
wife of Vatke Saharonian, famous poetess Armenohi Tigranian, sister of composer Armen Tigranian. And Armenohi Tigranian had a salon in Yerevan during the First Republic. And Armenian intelligentsia was coming together there. And perhaps from that period, Fetvajian was in touch with her. And Fetvajian met these people who became emigrants and were missing their homeland. There are photographs of Fetvajian with famous intellectuals, including Armenohi Tigranian, and many years who were unable during Soviet period to tell who is represented there next to Fetvajian. And even I remember one case when Yusuf Emanvelian was in National Museum. She was talking with explorer of Armenian coins and paper, and who asked her about Fetvajian's illustrations of paper money. He asked if he asked Yusuf Emanvelian, "I have heard that he illustrated Armenian paper money." Yusuf was ready already to answer. I immediately said in English, "Don't say, stop." Maybe she remembers that. I didn't want to damage research on Fetvajian. Because father, I was lucky that somebody passed by, some of the scholars working in the museum. And Henry Sarkisian was attracted by conversation with him and forgot about his question. And I immediately said, "Lucinda, if you will tell, we will have problems later with the investigation of art of So we stopped that situation. And now we can't face such a situation anymore. We can easily and freeway say that, yes, Fetvajian was close to these intellectuals. And he was very close to Hamaster, our brilliant writer, who was also living in Ambarsun Gelenya, Hamaster Penley, famous writer, who was also living in Boston. And when the obituary of Fetvajian was published in Hayrenik, so Hamaster and Chakmakchan were among those who signed that obituary. Fetvajian not just painted, restored, washed, decorated certain Armenian churches in America or did certain other works, but Fetvajian also he published a book of his aphorisms. This is one of the unique books of Armenian aphorisms. There are not many writers in the world who wrote aphorisms. Fetvajian wrote aphorisms during all periods of his life. And this is a unique book which appeared in Boston in 1939. Fetvajian also organized Armenian chapters in an exposition of nations living in America. He went from house to house, asked for different artifacts, received them with receipt, and then when he organized the exhibition, and Armenian part was really very well organized and attracted numerous visitors. Afterwards, he again distributed all this silver work, or textiles, or religious vestments, or illustrated manuscripts, distributed back to their owners. So, Fetvajian, in those years, published very important articles. I want to mention one and two of them, which are unique, really unique. One was published on the goddess, on the head of goddess Anahit, which is in British Museum. He explored in the archives of British Museum, being in London, how come this goddess head with the hand came to London. Unfortunately, those people who documented in the archives of British Museum, they never did an effort to go farther to those people who first found that. because the goddess passed from hand to hand till reached London. And many years this article was unknown to our archaeologists. This is unfortunately, because it was explored by Bakken Arakelian, former director, most famous archaeologist in Armenia, but this famous scholar, even in 60s or 70s or 80s, didn't know about that publication. Another very important paper that he published in Hellenic, this one was published in Vienna, in Mkhitaryan's congregation journal, Handes Amsorya. And second one, which I want to mention, it was about the technique of Armenian miniaturists. This is unique paper because there are a couple of things, small other articles published by Taragros or later by Durnova, something written about this technique. So Fetvajian's article is also on this technique of old miniaturists. It's also very important. I can't imagine that such a famous person, such a respected person as Fetvajian, he was unable really to find a sponsor, commissioner for these publications for him. But that happened. And the train is gone. Now we are trying to accomplish something else, to make him not be forgotten, to make our public in diaspora and in Armenia know about him, to be inspired by him, to see that we have such people, not just, you know, some mafiosi or, I don't know, corrupt people, but brilliant intellectuals who devoted their life to their nation. Fetvajian was not just painter, art critic, or art historian, or he even designed the project, he made a project for Armenian church in London. Many people who visit Armenian church, St. Sarkis Church in London, which is erected by Galus Gulbengyan in memory of his parents, his father, many people don't know that he touched that project. And there is, up to now, they are mentioning the name of British architect. But it is made by knowledge of Armenian architecture that any architect was unable to do without seeing Armenian, any British architect was unable to do without seeing the originals. So, Fetvajian made his impact here also. And Fetvajian was not just aesthete, writer, painter. He translated from Italian, translated from French, certain things, and published it. He, even during Armenian-Azeri clashes of 1905, 1907, even that time, he was a member of some board in Odessa, on the Black Sea shore, port, part of some Armenian port, which was gathering shoes, dresses for those who suffered from these clashes and lost their houses, lost their property, for Armenian refugees. During First Republic, during war with Turks, he was member of a board which was recruiting volunteers to send to fight with the Turks. Fetvajian always was with his people. Fetvajian was always doing something which was considered very important for his people. Fetvajian passed away in 1947 in Boston, and after being for a while in hospital. But before going to hospital, he was able to pack all his paintings, all his archive, written works, manuscripts, and Armenian caravan, this caravan of Armenian-American repatriants brought to Armenia. The head of caravan, Arshag Fetvajian, who is part of my family, he received it and brought and gave to Armenian National Gallery And unfortunately, Fetvajian was unable to see any more Armenia. And he passed away here. And when his collection reached Armenia, there was open exposition immediately in National Gallery, and also another exposition in 1956. And afterwards, he was forgotten for many, many, many years. Of course, articles were published about him, certain articles, even later. But I think that only last years we are starting really propaganda of his work. It's impossible to forget such people. These people give meaning to our existence. These people encourage us, show that one person can do a great job if he decided, if he is understanding his mission, why he came to this world. And what can I say? It's possible to talk about him for many, many hours. I have devoted many days of my life to Fetvajian. Thank you very much. Yes, please. In Yerevan.
May I just say that many evenings my father used to sat in the living room close to my bedroom and talked and talked and talked about history, literature, and everything else. The last sentence they uttered before my father took him to his apartment was, Baron Fetvajian, let your vote. And Fetvajian said, I owe the house. That, I remember they did that every single time after hours of discussion. My father would say, Leds Jovute, Chair, Baron Fetvajian, he said, I owe the house. And then he took him home.
Yes, please.
And my father, you know, the mother, of course, sheltered him, and so on, for years and years and years.
Okay.
Let me add a few things.
Just step.
I have an amazing memory. But my father went to New York with a terrible hotel, and he related how he wanted to buy his painting, but then decided to bring it. I was 2 years old. Pike and Lucy were not born. So his first years were with me. And I remember his paintings all over the walls and all of his sketches. And he also was giving lectures at Harvard. I was there. And he used to lecture in all the various Ivy League colleges in French, although he did know English, he knew how to read. Then there was a Professor Kenneth Conant, world authority on in Harvard. And he said, when I married my last wife, my first wife died very young, 34. My mother said, you got to help the Armenians. And then she gave me the name of Kenneth Conant. I just came across it today in Harvard. He was world famous. And what he did was he said, I went to visit him at Wellesley in his home. He said that Fetvajian's work make a lasting impression on me. There's no thing like that in America. It's valuable beyond the borders of Armenia. And he gave me letters. He wrote four letters to me. I went and found them. They were in the basement of the Batrasera, underneath the pipes. I said, what are they doing there? And on top of that, because he spent 20 years, I don't know if he told you that, 1890 to 1910, doing all those sketches, 20 sketches. And I tried to get I had a letter from Professor Fry, I tried to bring a professor to help Professor Thompson. But I also had the letter from Conant. The Conant one, they permitted to bring them out. And they brought them here, and Conant was going to publish them. Unfortunately, I turned them over to somebody who I never should have turned them over to, and they never were published. If Kenneth Conant published them and Harvard published them, he would have been known all worldwide. All right, I cried more than at somebody who should have known better. But it's my fault. I trusted people that have my same ability or don't. One more thing. Fetvajian was, he lived on Dwight Street, had an English landlady who spoke with an English accent and who treated him with such dignity. It was just very fortunate there. I spent a lot of time back and forth with him, and he'd have paintings. The issue is that Kohner, I also had a grant through Brandeis University. He got all these published. But I trusted people who aren't competent. I won't say more. Other than that, one more last thing. You didn't wait. I haven't finished yet.
Okay.
One more. I'm sorry. That's very important. Since I saw these paintings of all these historical monuments and so forth, I went to Boston last week. We moved to Boston. Boston last week, we read a book by James Henry Breasted. He was a very, very famous historian. He had almost very little, he had very little on the Armenians. I had been educated, not only the first to visit our house was Arshag Fetvajian, about that culture. And when there was nothing there, and also nothing in the Fine Arts Museum, I vowed that someday when I grow up, I was a freshman at Boston Latin School, I would found a museum. My brother wanted to found a library, and fortunately, I was able to trust it to a museum. The real name, ratified by voters, I mean Museum of America. The other issue is that we owe to Breasted, which got me angry, and Fetvajian, because he had the whole history on my walls. And that's why the museum is there. The name Alma, Reverend Hartunian, I guess to make my brother happy because he defeated him.
Began, let us not...
Wait, I've got to get the truth.
This is not the time. Began.
All I'm going to say is that the name Alma means apple in Turkish.
We're
I don't
we're
like
talking
it,
about
I hate it.
Fetvajian, but thank you.
It means apple in Turkish?
I keep getting it.
Yes, Lucy, yes.
Can you speculate about why the benefactor advised Fetvajian not to take the scholarship? And a quick second
question,
did Fetvajian
have any students to train following this book? The question is, if it was possible to find out why that unknown benefactor advised Fetvajian to refuse a Turkish prize. The second question, if Fetvajian had followers. So, first question, the answer of first question is that a non-benefactor told that Fetvajian must not return to Turkey and go and serve to his nation, to Armenia. This is the answer. And second, that he never taught Armenian art to have students. He had no students. No, unfortunately.
We were told that when he was given the money to go to Italy and study by a rich Armenian, that man said, "Don't ever come back here. This is an evil place." And that's why he was wandering around.
One of the wise people who were predicting perhaps what would happen to Armenians. That's why he didn't advise to return to Turkey. Other questions? No questions. Thank you.
Come on, thank you. Your enthusiasm and knowledge of the subject is fantastic, and thank you for sharing it with us.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.